nice just to start with a film and then kind of get into the more boring aspects.
I think our conversation sort of was a tangent over the idea of the difference between relativity and Newton's idea of gravity, the tethered by some full force, and as they moved, the thing just sort of followed along as if it was a string pulling it, or something that was spinning in centrifugal force, you know, like if you spin an object. And with an object with a string to it, it'll form a straight line and just travel in a circular path, or whatever path. And Einstein's idea that things weren't really connected by a string, they were connected by a fabric, a three-dimensional space-time fabric. And if you think about it in two dimensions, it would be like if you stretched a really thin membrane, put a really large object in the center. It would make a depression, and three-dimensional in space, that's happening in three dimensions, of course. And that depression is the curvature of space-time, and things just follow the path of the curvature of space-time that objects, depending on their mass, produces. Then we sort of got up, you asked me about deja vu, and I sort of got on a tangent about quantum mechanics and entangled states of electrons and various things like that, and multiverses. How if an object, you know, exists and it has the ability to be in different states at the same time, if a probability exists, it must exist in all the places. So like in a photon, if it strikes a mirror at an angle and it has a choice to be able to go through the glass or be reflected straight up at a 90-degree angle, you know, if it hits a 45-degree surface, you know, both of those are possible. So the electron at that moment must exist in both positions. It must be traveling off, you know, a 90-degree angle and then traveling straight through. So that's sort of a concept of the multiverse. So all these particles, subatomic particles, they're all doing this all the time at the quantum level, and it's just a probability. You can't determine where anything is or what it will do. It's just a probability, and if you look at this probability over a long period of time, you'll get the percentages, you know, and that'll confirm your theory is right, but you won't be able to say, okay, this electron will definitely do this, no more than you can say, if you flip a coin, you know, 50-50 times, 50-50 chance, it'll be heads or tails, but you can't predict whether or not it'll be head or tails, but, you know, if you do it enough times, you'll get a 50-50 ratio. And then it went into deja vu where, you know, if we blew this up on the micro scale and tried to apply it to things like the size of a whole universe or planet or you know, everything that happens, you know, everything you do in your life, you know, it may exist in a parallel universe or past lives or happening simultaneously, who knows. But you might live your whole life doing everything you did up until a point with one little change, and at that little change, you know, your life changes from that, but everything else would be the same. And deja vu might be some sort of connection that we may or may not have. I don't know, you know, like some type of entanglement states between these various selves of yours throughout the multiverse, you know, and you remember doing something, you know, it's almost exactly the same and maybe exactly the same up until the point that you turn left instead of right. But you might live your whole life doing everything you did up until a point with one little change, and that little change, you know, your life changes from that, but everything else would be the same. And deja vu might be some sort of connection that we may or may not have. I don't know, you know, like some type of entanglement states between these various selves of yours throughout the multiverse, you know, and you remember doing something, you know, it's almost exactly the same and maybe exactly the same up until the point that you turn right instead of left.
So I came to art in a crisis of sorts. At the age of 17, 2 weeks before my 18th birthday, I was diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoblastic lymphoma. And kind of everything about my life started to change. At the time, I was an athlete, I was playing soccer, I was very involved in student government, things like that. And I had to quit all of that and start doing chemotherapy. And so I was going to the hospital about 4 times a week. They would send me home my work, and I'd send it back. But with the help of a lot of people, I still managed to graduate on time and got into the University of Virginia. But while there, it was still very hard for me. I was only about halfway through my treatment. It was a 3-year treatment plan. So I was about 1.5 years through. And so my first year didn't go well. I stopped going to classes. I was on my own going back and forth to treatments. And I was eventually put on academic probation and told to go home and finish my treatment until I came back. And so when I came back to school, I went there to study biology or some sort of science. I thought maybe I'd be an orthodontist or something, but I was no longer interested in hospitals or medicine and things like that. I tried psychology and that wasn't really working, and I found myself in drawing classes and really enjoying it. And so that's how it all kind of started to happen. I started studying film. That's me bald. That's me bronze pouring. That's my film professor there. I joined a performance group and started getting into that. I started going on trips. And it all kind of started fitting together in a way. I was finding things interesting again. And so my early work was a lot about that. It was about hope and dreams, I guess, longing, reaching. I worked from books that I'd read. The title of this one, The Vertiginous Sky, came from a Nabokov story, a quote from a story about the quote, "People invent crimes, museums, and games only to escape from the unknown, from the vertiginous sky." This one I was working from a Chaucer poem I was reading about, it was called The House of Fame, and it was about our construction of memory and through language and our idea of fame. And so I was cutting images up and putting them back together and kind of recontextualizing them in my own sort of order of things. And sort of working in that way to solve puzzles or create puzzles. For this one, I was thinking about a Maya Angelou poem about a caged bird and sort of my relationship to that idea, my longing and things like that. And so my ideas were kind of all over the place. I began ruminating pretty intensely on the ways that I'd been struggling through life. At this point, so much had changed in terms of what I valued, what was important to me. It was very hard to communicate all these things with my peers who hadn't had that same life experience that I had. I began to think a lot about exhaustion in my work, and that put me on, I started doing these exhaustion films. So, in these, I would ask participants to perform one action until they were completely exhausted. And the films play out for however long that takes. So, Anthony plays one note on the saxophone for an hour. Jack swims for an hour and a half. Jeff smashes rocks for about 15 minutes. And I found it very interesting kind of playing with the idea of scores, chants, things like that. A lot about exhaustion and work in terms of my art, and asking not only why I made art, but why I do anything, became kind of a question. That was a question that I had just in general in my life, trying to find a new purpose after all the emotion of my high school. At the time, I was reading a lot of Kafka and thinking about the futility of action, the illusion agency in a way. I had this fear of death, and in the sense that, you know, I wanted to accomplish something in life, but no longer knew what accomplishing something meant. And so that's how I kind of got into these things and into these films as series. No matter where you skip to it, it's the same action. It just kind of has a natural beginning and end to it. And I became interested in the reality of these situations and the value of time and then that relationship to the body. Or the limitations of my body. It was another thing that I really was experiencing in my life and then wanted to communicate in my art. And so, limitations. And so my work kind of began to be a lot about that structure. This was kind of borrowing from John Cage, 4 minutes and 33 seconds. I just filmed lettuce being microwaved for 4 minutes and 33 seconds. And so it's a silent film, and it was about kind of the structure of film and time. Thinking about film's direct relationship to time, and then again thinking about it in this terms of scores. I started experimenting with the limitations of my art-making materials, and so this was Bolex Tag. I got three of my friends together, everyone got a Bolex film camera, and 100 feet of film, and the object of the game was to capture people on film without getting captured on film. The game ends when everyone runs out of film, so there's not really ever a winner. So the way then time gets valued was interesting to me. Because everyone shoots their roles at different rates or in different ways, but because of the way the film functions, when you play back 100 feet of film, it's going to be 2 minutes and 49 seconds either way. So I was projecting these on 4 walls in a room. And then the materiality of my art-making materials became important, sort of pushing the limits of whatever I was using to set the structure of the films or of the art. And so then sculpturally, this also became a way in which I was working. Then I came back to kind of trying to communicate my experience in life. So this one, Growing Up Black, just to explain the formal elements of it, it's a cup it was filled with ink. I drilled a hole in the bottom of that steel plate there. And then over time, over the course of its installation, the ink slowly dripped out. And I was trying to talk about my experience growing up black in America. At the time, I wrote, "Growing up black in the South, my condition was a spotlight. As a child of two professionals well enough off, I often found myself wedged into social groups where my skin color made me unique. My actions seemed noticed, my accomplishments measured. I was taught to fear the way people might see me. No matter how much you accomplish, they'll never see you as an equal. Stop sagging your pants, or they'll just think you're one of them. At school, I was called Slave Boy, and my first Valentine told me her father would never let her date the black boy. My presence felt messy, my being a burden, a steely shadow, trying its best to balance a glass cup spilling ink on everything." And so, compared to my early sculpture, you might have noticed, I really started to limit the materials that I was using and trying to really draw out the power that each material had. Thinking back, the swan, it had just every material that I could find thrown into it, where I really started to limit that in creating meaning in my work. For this one, again, thinking about process, I started with the idea of if a tree falls, does it make a sound? Well, of course, but if no one hears that sound, does it really matter? If Schrodinger's cat is still in the box, is it still alive, or does it matter whether or not it's there at all? And so I put my notebooks and sketchbooks and journals in a chest, and then I poured bronze on it so that the chest could no longer be opened. I buried half of it in sand so that half of it remained untarnished while the top burned. I had someone taking photos with a disposable camera as record of the process, but then I glued all the photos together so that you could only see the top photo. And so I was kind of speaking metaphorically, but again, using the process, using the whole process as language, because you can see, I don't know, the way the bronze falls, you can see kind of the whole way that the sculpture is made in solidified form. For my sculpture of Heartbreak, I had someone dropping eggs at a height, and I stood at the bottom and tried to capture the falling process with a Polaroid camera. So I'll just watch a few seconds of this. And so I was interested in memory, in ways in which we remember. I was thinking about the ways that heartbreaking moments have informed my view of the present or the future, but the way that that memory becomes cloudy, or as you keep referring back to that memory, it starts to change, it becomes blurred. And so then I put the Polaroids together in a line, sort of like a mobile, and then put the eggs back together at the bottom of that. And again, it kind of shows the whole process of how I made it, but all together, they speak metaphorically in a way, I think, because you see the conglomerate of things as they've been put back together at the bottom. You can look at the pictures and see the eggs falling and how it happened. I kind of had a bronze nest at the top of it as kind of the quintessential basket for the eggs. Planned obsolescence. I was working with the popular idea, planned obsolescence, your cell phone is made to break so that you'll have to buy a new one. So I made a machine made to fail. I put a water pump in a fish tank and had it kind of loop into itself, and then just added concrete until the pump failed. But I filmed the whole series, the whole process. And so the film kind of documents the way it's made. I had the film projecting on one wall and the sculpture in another part of the gallery. And so the sculpture kind of solidifies the whole process, or becomes a record of the film, whereas the film serves as a record of the sculpture being made. But at the same time, it all kind of started to speak metaphorically for me, just about the body, kind of like maybe poisonous honeycomb or something, the way that your body is constantly working through things and eventually could fail. Speaking back to kind of sort of my ideas about mortality, the exhaustion films, the futility of work. So I really was starting to try to develop an artistic language within which I could be productive, where I could have an idea and kind of sort it out in a way that worked with the other things I was thinking about. And this was also kind of the first time I combined sculpture and film. Which was also kind of, a stepping, a milestone for me, and began to inform the ways I worked in the future, because of the way that film speaks to the idea or communicates differently than sculpture. Because without the film, just having the sculpture, you wouldn't really understand the process, but just having the film, you wouldn't see the way that the concrete set and it became a solid thing. And so one of the next things I did was a collaboration with my friend Jack, who you saw swimming. You'd walk into this booth here, there was a film projecting on the backside, and a camera monitoring the space. And it was set up in a way that if you moved, the film would rewind. And so the film was simply Jeff, who you saw smashing rocks, taking off one article of clothing every 30 seconds. And so you'd stand in the room watching Jeff undress, but if you moved, it would rewind back to the start. And so there were set checkpoints, so if you made it to him taking off his jacket without moving, you would then always be rewinding back to him taking off the jacket. And so the film raw plays out in about 10 minutes, but people would be standing in the room for 20 minutes, 30 minutes, trying to see the whole thing happen, only to see him naked for 3 seconds and then it was over. And so I just thought, again, that was an interesting viewer interaction, the way that their bodies had to activate the artwork in the same way that their interest has to kind of activate the exhaustion films I was doing. I liked sort of this reciprocal relationship that they had to Jeff taking off his clothes, like as much as it was tantalizing, it was exhausting for them to have to stay still. And then it, again, kind of avoided a sort of climax in a way, because, again, you're standing there for 20 minutes just to see Jeff naked for 3 seconds. But the experience then became important. You know, everyone would come out kind of laughing at the fact that they did that, but also really appreciated the fact that they were able to accomplish that. And so around the same time, I started doing this mastery series, which was in kind of response to the exhaustion films. So the exhaustion films were do something until you can't do it anymore. And these were do something for the first time until you can do it twice perfectly. And so I gave myself a tattoo until I could make 2 straight lines. Someone else learned how to roll a cigarette until they could make 2 perfectly. Someone else learned how to play the major scale. And these weren't as successful for me as the other ones, but it was the first time I used my own body. And that became an interesting step in my work in the way that it allowed me to push the boundaries of maybe the ethics of what I was doing. A lot of the questions were like, well, why aren't you the one doing the exhaustion films? Why is it unethical to be, or objectifying, to be getting other people to do these things? And so using my own body gave me a way to kind of explore further in the things that I was interested in. And I also started to understand this sort of empathetic quality that using the body has, the way that you can kind of sympathize with the subjects of the films. So you don't actually have to perform them yourselves. You can imagine your own body in relation to the body on the screen and understand the way time is wearing on them, the way their actions are exhausting them, the way I'm learning in the same way that you learned something else. I started doing these endurance films where I would charge cameras to their full battery and then sit in front of them until they died. But it still then became, it kind of gained a greater metaphorical value in the sense that it was about more than that. I think it became kind of about the relative value of time in a sense. Because I was also doing these films where I would do something for the duration of an SD card. So I would perform an action for 8 gigabytes. So in this one, I turn my alarm clock off every minute for 8 gigabytes. Thinking about then the relative value of things, you know, 8 gigabytes equals 43 minutes equals 43 times turning off my alarm clock equals what have you. And then also, again, thinking back to using my body as a tool to think about other things. So the sexual nature of things, the politics of my skin, the presenting sexuality, all these things that extend kind of beyond the formal construction of the film. And then sort of my life, or the value of my life then compared to another, or the value of my work as an artist compared to the work of something else, were all sort of things that I started to think about. And so, lastly, I'm just gonna kind of talk about the last show I had. It was called Outside. I'll just read the statement from that. It was, currently my work relates to a search for identity by means of sculpture, film, and body art. I hold a strong attachment to my right to self-identification in parallel with contemporary and social political movements where the margins refuse to be defined by the center. I explore my maleness, my blackness, my personality, and privilege in ways that I find constructive in a very material sense. I draw inspiration from the idea of the self-made man. And so this whole show kind of started with in response to the election in the United States and the new wave of whites, like acceptable white supremacy. And it was interesting. This was my thesis show, and each thesis you get paired with a partner. And I was paired with a strong Trump supporter, just to kind of, it was kind of ironic. I'm not really going to talk about her work in relation to that, but to explain the paintings on the walls. And so I was thinking about all these things that I kind of talked about in my statement. So I had the films, the white balance films next to the durational films. And I'll kind of talk about each sculpture. This one was called American Entertainment. I was thinking about the idea that most of the movies and television shows that come out of Hollywood seem to assume a white universe, or a universe where the straight white male is the center of things and the rest of the characters are there to kind of find where they fit into that structure. And so it was, you know, and they kind of celebrate that idea, and so they're nylon balloons that if you look at them enough spell out white, but they're very shiny and reflective. You kind of see yourself in them. I made these kind of anti-Trump hats in a way. You don't know, Donald Trump kind of resurged this slogan from Reagan's campaign. A former president, make America great again. But, you know, he did it in a way that, you know, it uses the language but doesn't really claim anything. And I was interested in that idea, and so I made anti-disestablishmentarian hats, which are a resurgence of a British 19th century political movement that called to a conservative movement that wanted to maintain church and state relationship, but now in the States is just kind of known as the longest non-science word. So it's a word that's kind of lost its meaning, or its former meaning, but I've reused it for my own purposes in the same way. And I also kind of found it funny to imagine that all the anti-disestablishmentarians of the 19th century couldn't have really understood everything that they were supporting by being anti-disestablishmentarians necessarily, in the same way that I'm not sure every Trump supporter who wears a Make America Great Again hat really understands everything that they're supporting within that, which is kind of true of any political movement. It's hard to understand what exactly you are supporting when you support that thing. I was thinking about the idea again that no matter how much I accomplish, I will still be less than this sort of white supremacy. And so this piece, You're Still a Nigger, kind of referred to this idea that no matter how much you accomplish in the United States, the white is supreme. And so I gathered all of my accomplishments, all of my pictures, trophies from my childhood, different things from my cancer treatment, hospital badges and things like that, the t-shirt I got for being in the hospital when I turned 18, pictures of my parents, my speech from my 10th grade, election, embarrassing emails, and kind of put it all in a sort of curated piece that sort of juxtaposed against that idea that my accomplishments weren't important or weren't just as valid as anyone else's accomplishments. And also, again, trying to kind of subvert language or as a sort of reclamation of power in the same way that I was doing with the hats. So there was a lot of wordplay and things in this show. I made, that is incorrectly labeled, but these were garments to protect against the suspicion of having a firearm. Axiomatic structures, it is literally the thing that it says it is. And I thought these were interesting in the way that they insinuate the body. And yet, it was kind of funny still to me, like the way that I would still be threatening in this suit, and this kind of relates also to a lot of the gun violence going on in the United States. There's a lot going on in documenting police shootings of young African Americans. And so I was thinking about tools I could make for myself to protect myself, kind of again thinking back to the idea of self-made or making things for myself. I made myself a name placard, kind of like what you have if you were taking a mugshot, that said property of Virginia. And I was thinking about my debt to Virginia, both negatively and positively, because I've grown up all my life in Virginia. After I go to grad school, I will have gotten my higher education from Virginia. My family lives there. But I have a debt to the university. I have a connection to both the violent history and the positive histories of the state. And so I was thinking about just all the ways in which you are indebted to where you're from. And then I took a mugshot, or I took a photograph with that object that I made for myself, with these neon lights, and sort of, again, subverting the language. And kind of, an assertion that I get to decide how I am labeled or how I am termed. using the subversion of language as a reclamation of power again, challenging the idea that I can only be proud of my blackness in certain circles, or even that my blackness means anything beyond just a word. I think the phrase like real nigga apply, like sort of harkens to rappers or athletes or something, but you know, I'm saying it is a man who makes sculptures and puts them in a gallery. And so all these things, I don't know, kind of work together, I think, in a way that really talked about what I was interested at the time was feel like my relation to, or my self-identification, and then within the politics of the times that are going on right now. So, kind of to end at things, my goals for my residency here, I started working on a landscape film of sorts, talking about the history of the land. I thought it would be interesting to make an exhaustion film here, if someone were interested. I started making useless tools back in the States, and that was a project I was going to continue here, which is just a utility belt that's too long to wear, full of tools that have I've sort of engineered their function out of them. So I have a glass hammer, I have a screwdriver that's too sharp, I have a rounded out wrench and things like that, I made rubber nails, plastered files or things like that, and then whatever else ends up being interesting.
Thank you very much.
I got interested in the foot and mouth epidemic. I've been talking a lot to Robert just about the way that the landscape has been shaped through the economy, through the cultivation of sheep, and the history that that has just with the way that life is in general here. And then kind of I want to relate that back to my life in the United States, so it's kind of just taking shape and exploring the land and exploring the folklore of things and the history, like the real history, and then kind of the way that history is written in order to shape sort of the way that we understand the landscape.
Do you have
the
Alex website?
Yes, sandywilliamsiv.com.
Interesting thinking about the work that's very much about identity, your identity, and thinking about landscape in terms of here and how that's very much tied up with identity of Cumbria and people that live here in even in small pockets. And how that might relate to your home.
Yeah, absolutely.
Those two things tie together. Interesting to see what you know what comes out of it. What works like it.
What kind of exhaustion film are you thinking of?
I'm not sure. I mean, it would kind of depend on who I meet and what kind of things there were to do. But, I mean, there's lots of things. It could be almost anything. It could be holding the ball above your head until you can't anymore, jumping, typing your name until you can't type it anymore. It usually just depended on, like, it was, yeah, it's different each time.
I really love the complex relationship, the work
most of the work seems to have between us, interrogating the body and notions of masculinity, notions of blackness, and then the medium that you use to interrogate that and the limits that that puts on each piece. I wondered if there was, you could talk a little bit about how you go about choosing the two elements, what you do and how you record it, and how then that develops the work itself. Whether those things sometimes come together by accident, or if you plan it, or
it usually starts. I guess with the edit, do you have like a specific one you want me to talk about? Or?
No.
It usually starts with the idea, and then choosing the medium to explain it fully. So, like the planned obsolescence one, it seemed important to both film it and then have the structure at the end. Whereas with the one where I poured bronze on the thing, it was very much just about like that final product, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But then with the exhaustion, film seems to be the most appropriate since it can capture the whole, video. Whereas film, a lot of times I use, the first film I played, film was the best to use because it gave me a structural limitation. I could only drop the, I dropped the chair until I ran out of film and then kind of put the film together from there. But it also, there is an element of chance a lot of times, like with that first film, I didn't really know where I was going with it, and then I met the guy Chris who speaks in it and was talking to him about deja vu, and I was like, oh, I should record you talking about this, and then I was just writing about deja vu anyways, and then it all sort of coalesced into a film. Where originally it was just supposed to be the chair dropping over and over again.
Was it the same chair each time, or did you use a different chair?
It's the same chair, I kept putting it back together.
Thanks very much for talking. Great. Got lots of different thoughts. I've got three questions, but I only expect you to answer one.
Okay.
So I'll give you a choice. One's about the extent to which you think about yourself having a pictorial practice.
Oh, what practice? Sorry.
Yeah, pictorial practice. The other one is about language and text being different things. And the other one's about who your source artists are. Which of those three would you like?
What was the second one?
Second one's about language and text.
Okay. Gosh, those are all very broad questions.
Well, the language and text one is about how, sort of relates to the other ones as well in a way. Thinking about what you said about trying to develop a language,
mm-hmm.
and then seeing how much of the work involves text. And then thinking about how that text is materialized, and there's different examples of how the text is physically materialized in some of the pieces.
Sure.
But then there are titles as well, so there's other forms of text
right.
in and around the work, and you made that interesting point about the piece with the concrete, the water, the film, and the sculptural object, and kind of said you need to have both these things in order that you can overcome the gap.
Right.
Between what the object is and my understanding of it. If
right.
you just saw the film, you wouldn't understand the object. If you just saw the object, then the film doesn't help. So I was wondering about that accessibility
mm-hmm.
and obviously the other thing in the text is in English
right.
as well. And I wondered if you considered using other spoken languages or written languages or, I don't know, just anything around your thinking about text and language and how it figures so prominently in your work.
Right, yeah, absolutely. So the titles, definitely I think, I try to use them strategically to kind of hint at whatever I'm talking about, especially if I'm working very formally. Because when you just approach the sculpture, it doesn't really have a context. And then I try to kind of push it in a direct. So a lot of times I try to let it allow for you to have thoughts about it before I point you in a direction. It's the same way with the suit, in that in the show it was just, you know, kind of a beautiful object against the back wall. And then as you interacted with it or you read the titles, then it kind of takes on new meaning, so it kind of gives you that space I can actually.
So was the suit piece also called American Entertainment?
No, that was my fault on this thing.
That's I guess that's the point in a way, that it was something in that era.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. So these were called garments to protect against the suspicion of having a wire.
Sure.
And so it helps you in that way. And I'm actually working on a film now that's in German, because for an American audience, it's kind of, it becomes sounds almost. I'm remaking a Kafka short story. And so yeah, I like to use language, thinking of art as a language. I try to use the text or the titles just as strategically as the materials or the media.
Yes, and just start thinking about what textual language and non-textual language, if there is such a thing in notions of reading a work, mm-hmm. and so on, kind of, because there's obviously such a strong literary aspect to where you began your practice. You're
right
in saying this was a, you know, this short story or this novel, or it was often that kind of thing that reminded me too of some of those Bruce Nauman works.
Yeah.
You know, where you kind of sort of materialize a saying, you know, like hand to mouth, mm-hmm. you know, or something like that.
Right.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I was looking at Bruce Nauman, I was looking at Joseph Beuys, I was looking at Andy Warhol.
Yeah.
And, you know, I just pick up influence from all over. My professor, Kevin Everson, is a pretty prominent filmmaker right now, and a lot of his strategies and working I've picked up on in sort of the way I structure things. And then what was the first question?
The first one was about I was struck with your personal narrative. You say that you were first at university, you went to drawing classes and you really enjoyed it and got into it that way. It seemed to me, I wondered then, I was making a connection between drawing, as in not mark making, but drawing as a pictorial practice, perhaps, I was imagining, and then how those early sculptural pieces were also pictorial.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what I was getting a lot out of them for that reason, and that they were very just sort of making a thing that was what I wanted it to be. That was still when I was kind of learning how to make things.
Mm-hmm.
And then I kind of started moving away from that and letting the materials communicate, or the process or the intent communicate, versus just making a picture of something.
Thanks.
How recent was the first film you showed us, Deja Vu?
I shot that over the summer and recently finished it. I mean, I'd say most of the elements came together last summer. I think I even showed Robert the raw footage when we were at Mildred's Lane together.
Mm-hmm.
But I've been playing with the text and taking things out and adding things in. So you could also say I just finished it.
So is it finished?
I think so. I want to say yes.
Because it disrupts itself in a way, isn't it? It's and is that sense of self-disruption, is that something that you are strategizing? That's because that's my impression of it, having seen it once. That it's very difficult to find.
Yeah, absolutely.
To settle on anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I've watched it so many times that I can filter, but I think when you first watch it, you can't really listen to it and read and watch the image at the same time. Like, I don't know, kind of like Deja Vu, you kind of have to keep going back to it if you want to.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that confusion to me was interesting. Mm-hmm. In that film, I wasn't really trying to say, this is something. It was more trying to communicate my confusion about life in general, or about the idea of Deja Vu and the way that it can take on so many different things.
But the persistent thing is that sense of destruction.
Yeah,
you know,
sure.
The chair, because that's the most, kind of, I guess it's the most, yeah, persistent element,
mm-hmm.
which you know, asserts itself over and over and over and over and over again. So it's fascinating, just that relationship between that element and those other two elements, which are kind of struggling. You know.
Yeah, sure.
And
and I'd add in that the fact that it was made on film had a really extra disruptive effect on it, because you were constantly asking what Shannon asked, how many times did the chair fall, how many times was it thrown, is this film cut, like, is this secretly a digitised film that has then been edited, all of those like, structural things were going into my mind thinking, well, this is maybe an impossible film, and yeah, it's happening. Yeah, so the fact that you ran the film is fascinating. That, you know, the film chose the length of the chair's
right.
distress.
and so I made two films from that footage, because originally it is only about 2.5 minutes, but then I did digitally edit it. But since I used film, and it kind of like has the camera flashes, and you can't really discern if you've seen that chair or not before, it keeps that quality of, you know, is it real? Which is the whole question of the film.
Any other questions from the group?
Thank
Sandy,
you all very much.
Thank you very much. That was a fascinating talk.
Can I just ask if a student would like to get in contact with you, Sandy, about like helping you with durational film or just having other questions, please do that.
Sure. Maybe my email would be best one here. Sandywilliamsiv@gmail.com.
I mean, perhaps the easiest thing to do is to drop down and see you. Sandy is camping out in the MA studio.
Yeah.
Leave a note, catch him in a corridor, see him in the refectory. I mean, he's here.
No,
might as well make use of
Yes.
Thanks very much again for coming.
Yeah,
it was really nice as well.
Thanks for having me.
Great.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Great. Sandy, thanks.